time, we were sort of looked down upon as because we were just models. But we were, in fact, the highest paid actors in the country.
From the very first one, it was a big success. And we went on publishing two Afrikaans and one English every month. And the Afrikaans ones sold something like 180,000.
All of us who acted in the picture stories, it sort of took us by surprise that we had this almost instant fame. I was used to it from London because I was a rock and roll singer. But for most of the South African actors, it actually caught them off balance, because wherever you would walk in the streets, in the shops, in the supermarkets, people would come up and say, "Kyk hierso, hier is Beauty on Tembarov. Here is Mark Kondo."
And I could, you know, I imported the E-type jag. So wherever I went, everybody looked at me as if it was me, it was my life in the books. Wherever I traveled, they thought I was busy doing something that they report back in the books.
Yeah, before we talk, my friend, let us relax with music.
When I started Beau the Untamed, the cowboy, I used to write the stories. One day, I wrote a script for a photo comic called Three Bullets for a Long Gun. And when I handed it in to get the okay, they said, "This is so good, it actually should be a movie." So this was one desire I'd always have, because ever since Clint Eastwood in Rome said, "Why don't you make movies in South Africa?" I'd had this longing to make a cowboy movie in this country. So I took the script Three Bullets for a Long Gun, I found a producer, I found backers, and we made Three Bullets for a Long Gun. And I made such a lot of money out of it that I bought the property to start my famous Bow Valley nudist resort.
Well, I started off as a crook, and I finished up as what is known as an organizer. I directed, dressed the people, made them up, fed them, read the script, wrote scripts. Whatever you see, that's what I did. It was a one-man show for organizers. In the beginning, it would take at least about 10 days to do a photo story. And eventually we got it down to 3 or 4 days, and the actual shoot would take one day.
A person who was a photo story actor was somebody who had more than four different expressions that he could use. Smile, that's easy, but fright, worry, can you be alarmed? All these expressions needed to be done, and they needed to be done with a face and not so much with the body, because you had to be stationary. Every time was a stationary picture.
And we learned all these various techniques of doing these things, because we tried movement, it didn't work. It had to be frozen all the time.
Let's say we're going to have an argument. Me and you are having an argument.
All right, then I'm going to do this to you.
Okay.
And you're going to lean back like that.
Like this.
That's it. Do you want me to hit you? I wouldn't punch you, I'd do that.
Right, and I would go...
Look, I'll go like this past you like that. You go, no, you're too... No, no, you...
Ah!
Yeah.
For example, if we were just having a conversation, how would we do it? And what would I do? Like that?
Exactly,
and
like
you,
that.
And you were showing me something across the valley? Is there a future for me in photo comics?
Yes, photo stories. Never use that word comics. We were people, not make-believe.
Well, I read them as a child. I mean, my brother used to collect them, and eventually I started developing a special interest in them because I thought they were so funny. I mean, the dialogue were very forced and often extremely hilarious, especially with the later ones. And then eventually when I started collecting them, I found more of the rare ones, some really strange ones, And I mean, they're just, for me, they're beautiful to look at. All the photographs are, I think, are very special. The covers of some of these are really nice designs. They've got a very special kind of awkwardness about them that I really like.
When photo stories first started in Durban, it wasn't Europeans, it was Africans. The first photo story in Durban, I believe, was called Samson. And then, do you remember one called She?
She's sort of a crime fighter that's got this special magic knife that she fights against the enemies with. The reason why I think She is so interesting is because black women were the most suppressed groups, and this is the only black photo comic that features a female lead.
Do you remember Chunky Charlie?
I think Chunky Charlie is also a really interesting character because he subverts the stereotypes of the male hero. He's fat and he's always very funny, which is something that you don't find in the hero. The hero is always very serious and very sort of parade.
And then there was a chap in the stores named Martin Poles, and somebody looked upon him as a second James Bond, you can say.
Well, I was on a business trip in Italy. There, the photo stories is quite big business. And I got the idea of making a story that continued with a sort of a lead hero or something like that. A gentleman named Mark Kondo, a millionaire that finances his own daredevil escapades all over the world and in South Africa. I was alone for about, say, a year and a half before Dr. Conrad Brandt was the next one that followed me.
I worked at Wentworth Police Station many years ago, and that was in the 60s, and I met the writer of the story, that was Basil Stalls. I met his wife at an occasion when I worked one Saturday. She wanted to license a firearm. And the next thing at the police station, she arrived back and says she's got a job for me as a photo story model. And they gave me the job as Dr. Conrad Brandt. And that was in the 60s. I have been doing it for more than 26 years. Yeah, Conrad Brandt was always a caring type of person. Caring for the next one, looking after their ills and well-being and broken hearts. The acceptable type of thing that the women liked to read because it was a clean, nice story.
A whole lot of the Grensvechter ones, and they're some of my favorites because he's such a ridiculous character. I mean, just look at him, and he's always this strong, silent type, and he's a complete womanizer. He always kisses the girl in the end. Net ek en jy, Rocco. Net ek en jy. Then obviously Tessa is a big favorite. The Tessa books are quite interesting because they have a very sort of implicit content. And this was published in a time where pornography was still illegal. And I think the term Poesboekie sort of evolved around the Tessa stories.
It was sort of the closest thing to a Playboy that we could get to without actually doing it. The theme was that the girl used her sex appeal to lure the crook to lower his guard so that she could then attack him or get the information that she required out of him. As the country became a bit more liberated in those terms and we had a different Tessa, we actually tried to move more closer to the sexual side of that particular magazine to see if that would actually change the rate of sale.
This is the cover of the very first Tessa comic. She fights with the most lethal weapon known to man. She fights with a 38, 22, 36 caliber weapon, deadly lethal to anyone who tries to best her. And there's some examples of areas in the comic where they specifically focus on the pubic area with text. In this specific example, the text says she senses how he's moving, and the main focus of this panel is on her pubic area. And, well, the text has got nothing to do with the image, unless it's she senses how his phallus is moving.
As far as the girls were concerned, our photographers always went to the top model agencies in the country. And all the Miss South Africas were only, and the beauty queens, they were all so happy to act in picture story magazines because it was also an advertisement for them. It was also an outlet for them.
You get some attention from ladies, of course, young ladies. I was single at the time, which was nice.
Most enjoyable.
I never thought of myself as a sex symbol. Photo stories was never that type of thing. If we had attractive looking women doing photo stories, well, then I would certainly try to get a date.
And we had a lot of fun doing these books. Well, there are some things at this stage I won't tell you about, but we had a lot of fun with that.
Yeah, well, look, it's no, we mustn't sort of bluff. After we'd been finished filming the magazines, which took 2 or 3 days, we always used to take the heroines out with us, and most of us ended up in bed with them. Yeah, we used to have sex with the girls. It was wonderful. We were stars. They were beautiful, sexy girls. And the chemistry was right. We used to have sex. Oh, yeah.
TV came out. The circulation dropped. And then they started to cut on quality. And then I thought, no, it's not worth it.
The whole media changed. I think people are still reading for escapist reasons, but other things have become more popular. It's photo comics has sort of died out all over the world.
All of us in photo magazines were under no illusions about the coming of television. We were actually hoping that we could do some of our photo story series for television. In other words, instead of acting in still pictures, we could become actors on television. But we knew that once TV arrived, that the sales of all the magazines would take a massive drop.
Photo stories was really like playing cowboys and crooks, and you got paid for it.
It was such a satisfying life. Every day there was something different. It's not like a humdrum dove that I used to have.
It was really a fantastic life. And I'm sorry that it had to end. Yeah!